Hey, I'm Scott. It's Azure Friday. I'm talking with Erich Gamma. We're looking at the Visual Studio Online experience and the live editing. You may have seen something like this on the web, codenamed the Monaco Editor. So we're in the middle of editing our application here. And in the previous video, you said something about the language service.
Right.
It's very vague. Where is it in the browser? Is it on the server somewhere?
Yes. So one challenge is when you do coding, you want to have fast responses, right? So if you do IntelliSense, imagine you have a round trip to the server all the time. That's not very pleasant. Also, we do all the smartness, right? We find these are really semantic references, right?
Right.
So this shows me that's orange is a write reference.
Right,
that's
so you selected here. Yes. And noticed not as a search and replace, but as a symbol.
That's really a symbol.
And it's here and here
exactly.
And here and here.
So and what happens behind it? We have an AST in the browser, which gives us the type information and allows for this reference
abstract
analysis.
Syntax tree.
Right. So okay. Which the language service is one of the key abstractions they provide us, right?
Okay.
An abstract syntax with type information.
So
and
you're
this runs in the browser.
Running in the browser.
Right.
Wow.
And the cool thing is TypeScript compiler itself is written in TypeScript.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we can do that.
I've talked in presentations about how we don't tend to use the power of the client. We treat websites like they're dumb.
We kiss you with that.
Right? Oh, you like
exactly.
That?
Exactly. No, because we run this in the browser, and the browsers are really fit today.
Yeah.
They have lots of memory, and even the Monaco code base, which is not shy,
mm-hmm.
around 200,000 lines of Java, of TypeScript. We can run it and have the analysis done in the browser. Of course, you hit these limits somewhere, right?
To be fair, of course,
right?
Of course.
So it's not
but
unlimited.
I think that there's a class of developer for whom JavaScript is basic form validation.
Right.
And there's a chasm that they need to jump over to write a legitimate application. And the prospect of writing something as complicated as a language service, it would be so much easier in my mind to just, I'll just send JavaScript to the server. Let those big beefy machines do the work. But you've
right.
got 8 gigs of RAM and a quad processor here
yeah.
in a multi-core jittable JavaScript engine not
exactly.
doing any work.
Yep.
Was it TypeScript that made that possible for you to have such a complex thing? Or could you have just written it in straight JavaScript?
Okay, so now you mean the Monaco thing?
Well, there's the Monaco thing, there's a language service. This is a full app running in the browser here.
That's the full app running in the browser.
Complexity.
It's right, that's Git integration, search, whatever, right? It's pretty rich. We started actually with JavaScript. We were the first adopters of TypeScript, which had another code name by then.
Oh, wow.
And we worked heavily with them because we are 200,000 lines. We want to have a good module structure.
Mm-hmm.
We use Node.js on the server. Right, you have common JS modules, we have AMD modules on the client to help us with the structure. So we really needed structure, and we found out once we got to 30,000, 50,000 lines of code, now our code became more like harder to change.
No? Mm-hmm.
It felt like carving code in stone, right? Because
yeah.
you cannot change it.
Afraid to change it.
Because variables have no global unique names, right, or functions, so you can easily rename. Actually, by the way, we can rename here, right? We have, just let me do some.
Really, so refactoring, and that happens in the browser.
In the browser, right. And actually see multi-cursor support here, right? You see
nice.
All the blinking there, right? We don't want that you lose that.
You have multi, so that's the real cursor, and those are the
yeah.
pseudo cursors.
Of course, you can also do it with the, oops, that was another one.
That was cool.
No, you can also, yeah, you can set your cursors as you want, right? And all the operations.
Wow.
Operate on the cursors, right? So just, okay, I just want to show
no,
you. It's a real app.
That's pretty cool.
You
that's,
want to
that's legitimate.
The metaphor is, no, if you code in a browser, you have to do it with comfort, right?
Of course.
So we don't, you should not feel speed problems.
Mm-hmm.
So you spend a lot of time in making this efficient. And
yeah, I don't want to type and then hit dot and then wait
exactly.
because I'm on a cell phone.
Yeah. So, but okay, we noticed we got to 30,000 lines of code. We
mm-hmm.
start to adopt more and more of TypeScript. And at some point, we decide we throw the switch. We rewrite everything in TypeScript, which costs us some time. But I
sure.
don't think we have gotten to this size of code that is maintainable, and we can evolve it
right.
without using TypeScript. So we're really grateful to the TypeScript guys.
So the editor is a component, and
yes.
then this the IDE Chrome, for lack of a better word, around it is itself another app. Which
it's
is consuming
yes.
this app. And you have a number of other sites that consume this. We talked about SkyDrive, the
mobile services.
Mobile services.
NAPA,
the SharePoint online.
Where you write Office extension.
Office extension.
And of course, TFS.
And yeah, right, and tfs.visualstudio.com.
See all the diff thing you can do there, that you can do in TFS, right? But I think, let me see.
Oh, here's your git commit that's been.
Right, exactly. So what change did I do here, right?
And just, can it diff that?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Word level diff, right? So that's all client side now.
And the scroll bar with the intelligence, that's part of the editor as well?
So these are markers, right? And mm-hmm. we decorate the code with, and you get change bars as you change. So if you go to, we can do inline. If you do that,
okay,
and you can
yeah.
even
so
edit, right? You can edit, and it will update. See, as
oh,
you
I see.
Stuff.
With the changes
and,
there.
Yep. So that's comfy, and I want to go back to the editor view.
And we're showing a Node application, but C Sharp? Can
so,
I do C Sharp?
So, interestingly,
as well?
Okay, you mean as a user?
As a user.
As a user.
I've got C Sharp and Razor and
right.
JavaScript and mixed.
Right,
mixed
so you know this app. You have shown it in depth, I guess, at the launch event.
Right.
So, that's a C Sharp app, whatever. You can do it, right? We can have the same change and run model.
Mm-hmm.
So here I have some CSS, right? I can change the background.
Well, and you even have some of the more advanced features that we've added, like color swatches.
You want to see some more advanced features?
Well, yeah, I would like to see some more advanced.
Can I quickly switch back to this guy?
Do your thing, man.
So more advanced features.
Blow my mind.
I want to blow your mind?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, the fact that there's the language services in the browser, it blew my mind. I always assumed it was on the back end. So I'm already exploded. And
you're exploded? Okay. So, right? You click
oh,
over.
Oh, is that peak definition?
Yeah, we get to that.
How did you do that?
No, wait, that's just control over. That's that. Now, peak definition is that, right?
Yeah.
You get the in-place thing.
Nice.
And
oh,
what we
wow.
also do is kind of no peak references, which, for instance, where is all the socket stuff used, right? We do peak references.
Right,
then you see all the references.
Oh, that's a nice UI.
Right, so. Darn, now I lost where I wanted to go.
You keyboard want to friendly too? Cut keys and all that?
Yes. As you want. So we give you, we make it very easy for you to discover this. We have mm-hmm. this widget now helps us to find your commands, helps to find your files,
mm-hmm.
also helps to find your stuff inside the file. Right, if I do an
see, this is funny.
Ampersand, and then you can navigate inside the file.
I've been trying to convince the ASP.NET team that while web forms is great and MVC is fun, web pages has such power. CSHTML files, JavaScript, CSS, HTML, and C Sharp in one file for small sites. My podcast sites are all done like that. And every time I have a small fix, I got to install Web Matrix, or I got to, you know, I mean, I got this. It's a hassle. And I always find myself out and about on a machine without that. So I'll be able to do that.
Yeah.
CSHTML
yes.
files.
Yes. Well, and CSS, we do also less, right? So
less too, cool.
Yeah, if you do less. Now you asked for it, right?
So yeah, yeah.
Because
that's complicated
show
stuff.
It.
Do you have any less in this document?
Oh, no, I have some
you do.
Less.
There you go. The chat one.
That's it, the chat one. Oh, that's a bit boring one. Let's take the other one. Which one did you have?
There was another less one that was...
Styles or less, I
styles.
Guess, right?
Oh, there you
see,
go. So
you
there's
have
some variables,
right? And you can, of course, this stuff we have, right?
Nice.
You know that one.
Color picker?
No. you know, you have memory, right? But of course, you have intelligence, a little bit intelligence for colors, right?
Oh, hey.
If you want.
Yeah, and you've got vendor-specific prefixes.
All this stuff.
Yeah.
And also note that this is now less, and you see you have the same.
Yeah, so you figured
semantic,
it out.
Semantic, it's again.
And selected it.
And you can do the same coolness with renaming, right?
Oh, okay. So, yeah, symbols are symbols. So
Behind the scene, you have to do the same as we do for TypeScript. You have to build a language service, which mm-hmm. produces some AST that allows for this analysis.
Does it bring down the language services for everything in the project, or does it do it on the first time it opens a less?
It's the first time.
So it says, he's bringing less. Let's get the AST and the information
right.
down.
So you're familiar with the AMDE?
Sure.
Modules, right?
Right?
So we use AMD modules, and around that we have some lazy loading infrastructure, right? You just have a descriptor loaded, and on the first load of the TypeScript file, we actually load the code using AMD.
Yeah, it seemed very responsive so far. Right. When you opened that .less file, we didn't feel it.
Yeah.
But the
yeah.
first time you loaded the whole thing, it didn't feel bad either.
That's true. That's true. Yeah. And actually, I can make changes in less, and if I want to compile it, I can even do that online here if I want to, right? So I can, you see this side-by-side editing now. Oh, that's the output window.
How are you controlling the compilation? Is it a make file, or is it a
We want to be minimal here, right? It's, we expose some commands, and I hope I have less installed.
You have a little console here, a little bash.
Do I have less installed? Oh, I have less installed.
So where is that? Is this a view on a remote console, or is this a pretend bash locally?
This is vrun. Maybe should I switch to the quick diagram of what we're running?
Yeah, let's do it if you have a diagram.
I have a diagram. I have this diagram, right?
Okay. Let's make that big on the big screen here.
Bigger than big. Okay, let's do that. Okay. So that's your website. Okay. Mm-hmm. You have one entry point, which is actually the URL to browse it, right? In this case, it's Fishbowl, one of these performance apps that I've written.
Sure.
Then we see here we have the other development side URL, which we can see looking in fbar, it's /dev in the end.
Okay.
Which gives us a second access point to the same file system. Okay. There's your dub root, there are your files in there. If you browse the site, you come in through here, right? No PHP, ASP.NET, and you access that.
Right.
Monaco is another server here. It's also a node server. And what we do when you, for instance, do a Git operation or when I run less, we fork another node process in here that runs the command. And of course, we bring you back this into the browser.
So you're giving kind of a little remote invocation.
Yes.
You're invoking commands, one command at a time.
Yes.
So there's no ongoing context or open shell. As I go, command, enter,
command,
enter.
No, command, you got it. Enter. It's exactly how it is. We fork one command at a time. We don't keep the state open. But for you as a user, it looks like.
Yeah, it looks like a persistent shell.
Like it's a persistent shell.
And it's probably more scalable that way, because you're not holding
out
some.
Exactly. That's what you don't want to do, right, in the cloud. Sessions and state.
So then you went back in the browser and went less C and did your less compilation.
Exactly. And if there is an error, right, let's add an error. I think this should work.
So we've seen before in previous videos the Kudu console. This takes that to another whole level and gives me not only a console and the ability to move around my application, but live editing, source control, and on and on.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, you have an older version, Chris. Oh, no, Liz. It's not an error. Oh, I did type wrong. Sorry, where is that file? It's in style sheets.
You're getting IntelliSense for your
files, right.
Your file movement as well.
Yeah. Should. Don't know why we don't get it right now.
That's okay. So people will be able to see this in the portal by the time this video is available.
Okay. Darn.
That's okay.
Now I want now. Okay.
See, now you're it's a challenge.
No, you okay. I'm at the wrong location. Sorry, I'm stupid.
Well, PWD, right?
Oh, sorry. No, CD. Public, right? Yeah, see, now we get the completion suggestion.
Oh, that's a little bit subtle, but yeah, you're getting the gray.
We can do that if you want. Yeah. But this is auto. We also do this in code, by the way, which is pretty nice. Now you get suggestion, you can tab through without even getting into
this directory is the home directory of what?
This is the public, the static content of the site, right, where all the JavaScript stuff is. And I think in here you have the style. Yeah, that's the style sheets. Okay, that we get to now. And then I want to do. Actually, we have it. I'm sure we have it here somewhere, right?
I wonder if I could get to the point where I could run grunt and yeoman and other things that are more advanced.
But you see now, see, I added the syntax error, and I get the.
Oh, and there's your syntax error.
There's the syntax error, and I can just click, and I'm at the error, right? So that's very lightweight built-in integration. You run the command, you parse the output using some well-known patterns, and you get it. So we support Jake, grunt, but you have to keep in mind. If you remember the picture from below, you run in the context of your website.
Yes.
Which means whatever you do, if you have quotas, you accumulate and you get charged for that. Right?
So in the sense of storage or
No. If you build, of course, it consumes CPU.
I see what you're
and
saying.
It gets charged, accumulated under the site's quota. Right?
On the site's quota.
Right.
Which I think underscores
subscription, right? Depends on which one you have, right?
So which underscores that the original point when I said, wait a second, is this live editing in production? He's like, no, this is a development environment that can be on its own subscription and managed its own way and build its own way.
Yeah.
Very cool. That's live editing in the Visual Studio Online, formerly codenamed Monaco Editor. Thanks so much, Erich Gamma.
Yeah. You're welcome.
It's Azure Friday.